Hello everybody. Welcome to this video on TCP sliding window protocol. So we know that in TCP for managing flow control, we use the sliding window protocol with a dynamic window size. So the TCP sliding window protocol, it uses different fields for acknowledgement of segments received by the receiver that has been correctly received by the receiver. So the acknowledgement will contain the segment or the sequence number of the next byte expected. And also, along with that, there will be another field which gives what is the buffer availability at the receiver currently, so that the sender can check what is the or check this availability and accordingly adjust its window size. So let us look into the details of this. So, as mentioned, TCP uses dynamic window size and window updates are received from the receiver. So, one is you have the acknowledgement which is received, which is the next sequence number expected by the receiver, and buffer, the window size, which is how much buffer is available at the receiver, how many bytes the receiver can accept next. So this information are sent by the receiver to the sender. So this is an example. So here you can see we have the sender and the receiver. So at the time of connection establishment, they negotiate this buffer size of 4 KB. Okay, so 4 kilobytes is the size of the buffer at the receiver side. So initially, the sender sends 2 KB of data with the starting sequence number as 0. So this is received at the receiver where 2 KB is stored in the buffer and remaining left out of 4 KB, 2 KB is left. So the acknowledgement which is sent by the receiver contains the acknowledgement number, that is 2048. Remember, TCP uses byte sequence number. So every byte is sequenced. So starting from 0, so 2 KB was already sent. So 2 KB means 0, sequence number 0 to sequence number 2047. So the next byte expected is 2048. So that is what is given here. And the window size is updated. Now, right now, the empty space that is there in the buffer of the receiver is 2048. So 2048 is the window size update which is sent. When this acknowledgement is received by the receiver now knows that it can send only 2 KB of data. So it sends 2 KB of data. And this is the sequence number. 2048 is the sequence number of starting sequence number of 2 KB of data. So this is received at the receiver and the buffer becomes full. Okay. So when the acknowledgement is sent by the receiver, its acknowledgement, the next sequence number expected is 4096. Okay. And window size has been updated to 0. So the window size you get is 0. So when the sender receives this, then the sender is blocked because the window size is 0. So the sender cannot send any more data until and unless there is an update. So at this point of time, okay, the application, so you have the transport layer, you have the application layer. So the buffers are here at the transport layer. So the application layer reads 2 KB of data. So 2 KB of data from the buffer becomes free. 2 KB is full, 2 KB is used and 2 KB is free. So now the receiver will send the update, okay? Acknowledgement remains the same because it has not received any new data. So the acknowledgement number is same. And now the window size is updated to 2048. So now when the sender receives this, it will send some data. So it is sending 1 KB of data and the sequence number is 4096. Okay, sequence number is this. So to send this, so now the buffer would look like this at the receiver. 1 KB of data, 1 KB, this 1 KB is free, and 2 KB. So when it gets this, it can send an acknowledgement. Acknowledge would be, it receives 1 KB. So it will be what? 4096 plus 1024. 1024 is 1KB. So 5120 would be here. 5120. And window would be 1024. So this is how the window size is being updated. Now we saw that when the window size was zero, when the window size was zero, then the sender was blocked. So the sender could not send data. But there were situations where it can send data, and there are two situations. One is it has to send urgent data. The sender has to send urgent data. If you can recall from my previous video, we had seen the urgent data and the urgent pointer. So if it has urgent data to be sent, then it will send even if the window size is zero. Or the second option is when it wants to know what is the updated window size. So the sender is blocked. It is waiting for an update, but it is not receiving an update. So it may happen that the update which was sent by the sender, by the receiver, is lost. So the sender can from time to time ask for or request for an update of the window size. And this is known as the window probe. So this packet or this segment is known as the window probe. So it is requesting the receiver to tell what is the current window size. Okay, so in that case, even if the window size is zero, it can send a window probe message to the receiver. So the sender sends it. This window probe is a 1 byte segment. Okay, and like I said, we may have a deadlock. That means sender is blocked. Okay. Receiver, it had sent that the window size is zero. So it is waiting. This is blocked. Now let's say window size has been updated. Window size is equal to say 1. Okay. But what happens? This message gets lost. So the receiver is waiting. The sender is waiting for this update. So it can go on waiting. And as a result, there may be a deadlock if this window update gets locked. So because of that, from time to time, the sender will send a window probe, WP, window probe, to ask the receiver to send what is the window size. So if receiver sends the updated window size. So that is a window probe, and this window probe is a 1 byte segment, and it can be sent even when the window size is zero. Okay. Then, TCP. This is TCP. TCP. Okay. It also uses the concept of delayed acknowledgement. Okay. Now, before we actually look at delayed acknowledgement, let's see this. Okay. So you have the sender and you have the receiver. Okay. Let us say the application layer at the sender is sending 1 byte at a time to the transport layer. So as this 1 byte is coming at the transport layer must put it in a segment, this 1 byte. Now when it puts it into a segment, it puts its header, which is 20 bytes. So this is a TCP segment. This must go inside an IP packet. So this TCP packet is 21 bytes. And again, the IP packet will be 20 byte header of the IP packet. So total, you get a 41 byte packet. So for sending 1 byte of data, you are sending 40 additional bytes. So now you can think of an example or a scenario, which is say a remote login. Okay, you have a remote login. What is a remote login? So here, let's say you are sitting at your home, okay? And this is the computer. This is the computer in, say, in the college. And this is your home. So you want to run some program which can be executed only in the college computer. Okay? So what you do, you have a facility of remote login, whereby you log in your machine. So when you're logging in, you are not logging in into your local machine, you are logging in into the remote machine. Okay, so that's a remote login. So you get a screen, login screen. So you type your username. So you, as you are entering the data from your keyboard, this data is actually being sent to the machine at the college. Okay, so you are typing, say, my first initial P. So I have typed P. So P goes into SAC, into this machine. Then I type R. Then I type O. So for each of these characters, each character is 1 byte. For each 1 byte, okay, a 41 byte IP packet is created and it is sent. So remember, so if I have a very long username, imagine how long this, how many packets will have to be sent. And also, as you are sending, the acknowledgement has to come back from the other side. Okay. So as the acknowledgement comes in, so acknowledgement also will be possibly 1 byte only data, but additional 40 bytes of data will be used. So all these together, just for the remote login, when if you are sending one byte at a time, the application is your remote login application, it is sending one byte at a time. So when you're sending one byte at a time, okay, the amount of data which is transferred along with is very less, but with compared to that, the amount of additional information that is sent in the form of IP header and TCP headers is very, very large. So that makes inefficient use of the bandwidth. Okay, so it would have been better if I could have typed maybe my whole login name and then I get one acknowledgement here. Okay, so let me just clear it up here. So here now, if I could, if the sender is sending very slow, is sending slowly, very slowly, 1 byte at a time, the receiver, instead of immediately acknowledging, should delay the acknowledgement. So I receive a substantial amount of data. I receive some substantial amount of data. It is sending one at a time, but I wait till I get substantial, and then only I send an acknowledgement. Okay? So this is known as your delayed acknowledgement. And TCP uses this concept of delayed acknowledgement. Okay, when acknowledgements and window updates are delayed for up to some amount of time in order to collect more data on which to hitch a free ride. Okay, so more data means you are acknowledging all of them in one shot. Okay, so you wait for a particular amount of time and then only you send the acknowledgement instead of sending the acknowledgement immediately. So according to RFC 1122, RFC stands for request for comments. And so this is the RFC for of number 1122. So when the receiver receives the data like this, then it can wait up to 500 milliseconds before it can send an acknowledgement. Okay. So it increases the efficiency of the bandwidth from the receiver side. So if I'm sending 8 characters. For each character, I would need 40 extra. So 40 into 8. Okay. So this is the amount of data which is sent. Similarly, for this also, I'll need 40 plus, say, 2 bytes. So for 8 characters, I will need amount of data to be sent. So now, instead of sending this, I'm sending only one segment, which is acknowledging all of this. Okay. So this is your delayed acknowledgement. So this increases the bandwidth efficiency at the receiver side. And now one more thing that is important here is this is known as the Nagel's algorithm, any way you pronounce it, okay? Nagel's algorithm. So now in the previous delayed acknowledgement that we saw, this increases the bandwidth efficiency at the receiver side, okay? From the receiver side, so the receiver now is reducing the amount of additional unnecessary data to be sent. Okay, what about the sender side? So this Nagel's algorithm will help in reducing the bandwidth wastage from the sender side. So at the sender side also, there are ways to increase the bandwidth utilization, and the Nagel's algorithm will help you to do this. So what is this algorithm? So this says that when the data comes to the sender in small pieces, send the first data and buffer the rest. So again, this is the application layer at the sender. This is the transport layer at the sender. Okay. So this application layer is giving small the amount of data to the transport layer. So the application layer is giving first one byte, let's say. So according to Nagel's algorithm, what should be done is when you are sending the first, when the transport layer gets the first, let's call it a piece of data, first piece of data, then it will send it, okay? And then it will take time for this to reach the receiver. Then it will have to wait for the acknowledgement, okay? It will have to wait for the acknowledgement. So during this time, the application may have sent some more data. So all this, it will not send it immediately. Instead, it will buffer it according to Nagel's algorithm. So it will buffer all this. So once this acknowledgement for the first piece of data is received, then the sender will send this entire data. Okay? And again, it will start buffering. It will continue buffering till it gets an acknowledgement. So what it does, first piece of data, it sends immediately. After that, it keeps on buffering. How long it will buffer? Till it gets the first acknowledgement. Once this acknowledgement is received, then it will send whatever it has buffered, it will send it. It will send all the data that it has buffered. And again, it will keep on buffering till it gets the acknowledgement for the second lot of data that it has sent. So in the first slot, it has sent one data. In the second slot, it has sent, say, X pieces of data it had buffered. In the third one, now again, it may have accumulated Y pieces of data. So it will send Y pieces of data and so on. So as you can see here, according to Nagel's algorithm, now it is the sender. Earlier, in delayed acknowledgement, it was the receiver who was delaying sending of acknowledgements. Now it is the sender who is delaying the sending of the data until it has sufficient data to be sent. Okay? So a new segment should be sent if enough data has tricked in to fill in a maximum segment. Now remember the maximum segment size, MSS, we had already discussed. So at the time of connection establishment, the maximum segment size between the sender and the receiver is already negotiated. So a new segment will be sent only if enough data has trickled in to fill in a maximum segment. So let's say my maximum segment size is 8 bytes. Okay, let's say this is 8 bytes. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 1, 2, 3, and 8 bytes. Okay, this is my maximum segment size. So now the first piece of data is sent. It is waiting for an acknowledgement. So say it has, now within this time, when the acknowledgement has received, by this time, let's say I have all these eight filled. Okay. In that case, I can send. Suppose all are not filled. Let's say I have only this one is failed, this is failed, this is failed, this is failed. So I will not send immediately. I will wait for all the rest to be filled in. Only after that, I will send this data. So a new segment should be sent if enough data has trickled in to fill in a maximum segment. So this is your Nagel's algorithm. Okay, but it is not that Nagel's algorithm can be used everywhere. So it is not suitable for interactive games with short, frequent updates. So if you are playing some interactive game, there are users in different sitting in different systems. Okay, and the updates are usually short, and it has to be updated frequently. Okay, this has to be sent. Otherwise, there will be a lot of lag. So it will not be interesting at all. So this Nagel's algorithm is not suitable for if you are using TCP to send updates of interactive games. So you don't. This is not a problem because this is just a feature of TCP which can be disabled. So this option, if you disable Nagel's algorithm, then it will not cause a problem. Okay. Also, another issue with Nagel's algorithm is that it may interfere with delayed acknowledgement to cause a deadlock. Okay. Just think of it, Nagel's algorithm, sender is waiting till it gets an acknowledgement to send more data. Okay, and delayed acknowledgement is waiting to get data before it sends acknowledgement. Okay, so if there is some loss of data or something, then you may have a kind of a deadlock scenario, okay? Because one is waiting for the other. So sometimes it may not be. These are some of the issues that can happen in Nagel's algorithm. Then there is one more problem, or rather not a problem as such, a scenario which may occur. Okay, so delayed acknowledgement and Nagel's algorithm, if there is very less amounts of data. So either the receiver is consuming the data which is sent is very less. Okay, you may have some other an opposite scenario where the application is sending large amounts of data to the TCP entity. Okay, so application is sending large amounts of data to the transport layer. Okay, but an interactive application at the receiving side receives one character at a time. So the transport layer at the sender side is sending large amounts of data. So this data, big data, will be sent to the transport layer here, and then the application layer at the receiver. So, but here what happens? The buffer is filled in with this, okay? But the rate at which the application at the receiver is reading the data is very slow. Say it is reading one byte at a time. Let's say this is 1024 bytes are being sent, but this is reading one byte only at a time. So it will take 1024 read operations from the application to complete reading this. Okay, so now how is this a problem? Okay, so let's see. So first, let's say this buffer at the transport layer is 1024 bytes. Okay, this is the buffer size. So, and the application is giving data at the sender side to the transport layer in chunks of 1024 bytes. Okay, so the transport layer is sending 1024 bytes together. So first time it reaches the buffer is full. Okay, so the transport layer at the sender will send an acknowledgement for 1024 sequence number. Let's say sequence number starts from 0. Okay. So it is acknowledging this, and it is saying that the window size is 0 because the buffer is full. Now what happens? The application has read one byte from here. The application has read one byte from here. So this one byte has been read by the application. So the buffer becomes one byte free. So what happens immediately? Let's say the receiver will send this window update. 1024 it is expecting, and window is one byte. Okay. So again, now TCP at the sender will send one byte. Okay. The sender can send one byte of data now. So sender sends one byte of data. Then again, this buffer becomes full now because only one byte was free. So this one byte is filled up. So again, window size becomes zero. Okay. So this can go on and on and on. If you look at this diagram. Okay. So first of all, the receiver's buffer is full. Then the application will read one byte of data. Okay. So there is one byte free here. So this will send a window update segment. A window update segment is sent. Okay. So the window update segment is sent here. The receiver will receive this and it will send one byte. So new byte will arrive here. When the new byte arrives, what happens? Buffer is full. So it goes back. Actually, it comes back here. So again, application reads one byte. Room for one byte. Window update sent. New byte arrives. Again, it is full. So this is known as a silly window syndrome. Again, let me just clear this up. So this is a silly window syndrome. Okay. Why silly? Okay, because it is just one byte is being released and again it is full. Again, one byte is released and again it is full. So here you have a sender which is sending large volumes of data and the receiver is reading very small units of data. Okay. So now, what is the solution for this? So this solution is given by a scientist called Clark. So this is known as Clark's solution. So what happens here? It prevents the receiver from sending a window update for one byte. Okay. So if Clark's solution is being used to avoid the silly window problem, so if the window update is only one single byte, then it is stopped. Okay. So the receiver is forced to wait till it has a decent amount of space available and advertise that instead of sending one byte. So instead of like here, this part, okay, this is delayed. This part is delayed. How long? Till it has sufficient amount of time, free space in its buffer. So this receiver should not send a window update until, what are the conditions? Until it can handle the maximum segment size it is advertised when the connection was established, or until its buffers are half empty, whichever is smaller. So until and unless the buffer area is half empty. So if the buffer was 1024, so when it is 512 bytes are free, then only it will send a update. Okay. And if, let's say, the maximum segment size that was pre-decided was, say, 100 bytes. If it was 100 bytes, in that case, when 100 bytes are empty, when 100 bytes are free, then only it will advertise. So whichever is smaller, either 512 or 100 bytes. So whichever is smaller, that will be taken. And so here 100 bytes is smaller than 512 bytes. So when the window, the buffer at the receiver is 100 bytes free, it can handle 100 bytes. Then it sends a update. Then the update is window update is sent. Also, the sender can also help by not sending tiny segments. Instead, it should wait until it can send the full segment or at least one containing half of the receiver buffer size. So here the sender also contributes. Okay, how? Contributes to this problem because it is sending one byte of data. Okay, so sender also must make sure that it will not send one or very, very small bytes of data, small sets of data. Instead, it will wait till it can send either a full segment, which is 100 bytes, okay, or at least half of the receiver's buffer size. So both the sender side, sender should wait before it sends small amounts of data, and receiver also must wait before it sends a window update until it has sufficient size to advertise. So this will handle your silly window. So what we are looking at, these are nothing but some of the problems that can occur in a sliding window protocol and how these are handled in TCP. Okay. And finally, this is also something which we have already checked. We have already done this before. That is cumulative acknowledgement. So in TCP, we use cumulative acknowledgements. So the receiver receives the packet segment 1, sequence number 1, 2, 3, 5, 6, 7, like this. Now, 4 is not reached. It has not received 4. 4 is lost. Okay. So when it receives this, after it receives this, it can send an acknowledgement saying, it is expecting 4. Now, the sender who has already sent 4 at some point times out here and retransmits our sequence number, packet with sequence number 4. So now it has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So the acknowledgement which will be sent will be, now it will acknowledge for 8. It will acknowledge all from 4 onwards, four up to 7. So that's why this was known as the cumulative acknowledgement. Okay. So TCP uses cumulative acknowledgement. Basically, these are some of the things that a flow control in TCP looks into. So just a quick recap. So sliding window is used in TCP, okay, with dynamic window size. So this we saw how it is used. Then for the sender to ask frequently, what is the window size? It will send a window probe. And then to avoid slow reading and of data, okay, and slow receive of data, we have concepts like delayed acknowledgments, Nagel's algorithm, and so on, and the silly window syndrome, which are some of the issues and how it can be solved. These are also mentioned today. So this is how the flow control in TCP is handled. Now in the next video, we will talk about the timer management in TCP. Thank you.